honored guests. Tonight, we are going to commemorate and celebrate a key milestone in the 200th anniversary of Taras Shevchenko's birth. Over the last 6 months, much effort went into preparing tonight's program. A small core of committee members have worked untiringly to make this event a reality. A dedicated set of performers and artists have diligently given their time. You, the community, have supported this endeavor with your suggestions, with financial contributions, and with your active participation. The preparation for this commemoration has truly been a community effort. We thank you. While preparing, as we read and rehearsed the eloquent, beautiful words of Taras Shevchenko, the Euromaidan unfolded before our eyes. Shevchenko's words became even more poignant. We're going to begin with a short video dedicated to the Maidan. This video does not attempt to deal with the recent Russian invasion. I know many of us are watching the news daily. This video is a composite of two short clips and a few photos from our own community's supportive actions. The first clip reminds us of the Maidan, its early struggles, and the need for everyone in the free world to support Ukraine. The second clip is a tribute to one of the heroes and first victims of this struggle, Sergei Nioyan. At the same time, it highlights Taras Shevchenko's role in Ukraine's future.
I am the Ukrainian, the native of Kyiv, and now I am on Maidan, on the central part of my city. I want you to know why thousands of people all over my country are on the streets. There is only one reason. We want to be free from a dictatorship. We want to be free from the politicians who work only for themselves, who are ready to shoot, to beat, to injure people just for saving their money, just for saving their houses, just to saving their power. I want these people who are here, who have dignity, who are brave, I want them to live a normal life.
Слава сеньори, три бої у путі, і вам лицарі великі, Богом не забуті. Борітеся, поборете, вам Бог помагає, за вас правда, за вас слава і воля свята.
Ladies and gentlemen, colleagues and friends, as we begin our celebration of Taras Shevchenko's bicentennial, Ukraine is undergoing its greatest trial and ordeal in its modern history. It has just undergone a revolution, its territory is now occupied, and there is a danger of imminent war. We are all hooked on watching events in Ukraine daily. We can't tear ourselves away from the screen of the computer to see what is going on. In that context, it might seem that a celebration of a poet seems something of a luxury, something that is not exactly fitting to the times. But I'm sure we all agree that it is precisely fitting because no one other than Taras Shevchenko exemplifies the spirit of Ukraine words that I have to say today. Obviously, there's a temptation to give a long talk, to speak as much as one can about Shevchenko, especially since this is my avocation, this is what I work on. But in the few minutes that I have, I would like to concentrate on what makes Shevchenko, Shevchenko. Specifically on his poetry, very briefly. Anyone who has read him in the original knows that the first thing about Shevchenko's poetry is that it is exceptionally and uncannily natural, seemingly simple. His friend and colleague and contemporary, Mykola Kostomarov, said that this is the way the narod would speak if it could speak that way. There's a certain paradox here. He speaks the way that people speak, the nation speaks, and yet he speaks differently. If you compare him to folklore, it is not exactly the same thing. It is a kind of a naturalness that comes from great artistic organization. His poetry is actually very sophisticated. And the testimony to that is that generations of critics and readers, and not only Ukrainians, have seen in Shevchenko an eminent poet, a poet of the greatest sophistication, one who holds our attention to the present day. A component of that excellence, of that sophistication, is that Shevchenko makes every poem a lived experience. We are watching a performance as we read the poem. Characteristically, he does not write in any of the canonic forms. He does not write sonnets or hexameters. The poem is written in a way that mimics, if you will, living speech. He is both the poet and the kobzar. And each poem is an inimitable performance. Characteristically, he writes in variants. Many of his poems are written in 2, 3, or more variants. The thing that exemplifies Shevchenko also is his emotional and psychological investment in the poetry, in his act of being a poet. He is continually there as a person. In this case, in this sense, he is so different from many of his contemporaries. Let me read you a few lines of this poetry, because any evening celebrating Shevchenko would be totally incomplete, and this one certainly will not be incomplete, and there will be more of that. But let me also introduce his poetry into my presentation. This is an excerpt, not the whole poem, this is an excerpt from the poem called Marina. It was written in 1848 when he was already in exile. Неначе ворон той летяче, про непогоду людям кряче, так я про сльози та печаль, та про байстрят отих глядаче, хоч нікому їх не жаль, розказую та плачу. Мені їх жаль. Мій Боже милий, даруй словам святую силу, людське серце пробивати, людські сльози проливати, щоб милость душу осінила, щоб спала тиха печаль на очі їх, щоб стало жаль моїх дівчаток, щоб навчились путями добрими ходити, святого Господа любити і брата милувати. Just like a crow that flies and calls to warn us of the coming storm, so I must tell of tears and grief and those abandoned bastard kids whom no one pities, and weep. I pity them. Dear God, endow my words with holy power to pierce the human heart, to shed real human tears, so grace can fortify the soul, so that their eyes can see the grief and they can pity my poor girls and learn to walk the righteous path and love their Lord and show some mercy to their brothers. Shevchenko's poetry is also characterized by a remarkable ability to evoke collective memory. Frequently, it has been called by the critics a sense of history, of him as writing historical poems. I think that is arguable. One can call it that, but it is more proper, I think, to see it as a remarkably sharp and deep sense of the collective experience, of what must be said and what must be re-examined. Re-envisioned. And the core of that experience is Ukraine. Ukraine as almost a sacred entity, as something to which he as a poet in turn is couched in remarkable biblical prose, poetry and diction that echoes the prophets and evokes a millenarian vision of a risen Ukraine. Of Ukraine that even while at his time is suppressed, is undergoing a kind of trial which we now see before a much stronger power, but his sense of history and his sense of the future is such that he is convinced, and through him we too, of its inevitable resurrection and triumph. And he couches it also, as I said, in the biblical mode. Here is a fragment from his Psalm 11, just a short fragment. Воскреснуя, той пан вам скаже. This is the Lord speaking, and his word becomes the word of the poet. Воскреснуя, воскресну нині, ради їх, людей захованих моїх, убогих, нижчих, возвеличу малих, тих рабів німих. Я на сторожі коло їх поставлю слово. I will rise up, that Lord will say, for them I'll rise up from the grave. For all my poor and fettered beggars, I'll raise them up, these mute and lowly slaves, and to stand guard beside them, I'll place my word.
Shevchenko, the painter. Tableau 1. I was born into a family of serfs. As a child, I learned the meaning of forced labor and bondage. Out of nearly 100,000 inhabitants of Shevchenko County in the province of Kyiv, where I lived, only a handful could read. My father, Grigori, was one of them. As a result, he didn't have to work in the fields and instead learned a cartwright's trade. He became a trumak, transporting salt and other merchandise he bartered or bought. My mother, who bore six children, kept working in the master's fields. She died before I turned 9. My father died 2 years later. My home, Yagbe Biznale Panichi, if you young gentlemen but you, says all I have to say about the system we suffered under.
Gentlemen, but knew how people weep their life away. You would not spend your elegies praising God's name in vain while laughing at our tears. You cannot fathom why you call a peasant hut God's paradise. I suffered in such a hut. My tears were shed there, my first tears. And I don't know one vicious thing in this God's world that doesn't nest there, but they still call it paradise. I do not call it paradise. That little hut within a grove by a clear pond at the village edge, that's where my mother gave me birth and swallowed me and sang her song and poured her grief into her child. And in that grove, hut that was in paradise, I witnessed hell, slavery, and endless work, and not a moment free for prayer. From there, from poverty and toil, my mother went to an early grave, weeping with his kids. We were all small and naked then. My father died in serfdom. We scurried around like mice to find some shelter. I went to school to carry water for the kids, and my brothers to be serfs, that is, till they were sworn into the army. And my sisters, woe to you, my gentle doves. What keeps you going on this earth? In servitude, you all grew up. In servitude, you all go gray. In servitude, my sisters, you all die. I shudder every time I think of that small hut at the village edge. Such are our deeds, O Lord, in this our paradise, thy righteous earth. We've made a hell of paradise. And now we beg thee for another. For after all, we love our brother. We harness them to plow our fields, which we then water with their tears. And while I can't be sure of it, it even seems to me at times that thou, for it is thy will, O Lord, that keeps us stuck and naked in this Eden. That in thy heaven, Lord, thou art laughing a bit at us and taking counsel with the lords on how to rule this earth. See, the grove is bending in the wind, and the pond beyond is like a canvas where distant willows calmly bathe their boughs. Sheer paradise, all for thy holy, sacred self and all thy wondrous deeds. Look more. more closely and then ask, what's going on in paradise? But of course, all happiness and praise, all for thy holy, sacred self and all thy wondrous deeds. But there's the rub. There is no praise. Just blood and tears and blasphemy. And everything is cursed. No, nothing. There is nothing sacred on this earth. I even think that the people have now put a curse on thee.
Suddenly the Baron flew into the room. He had me whipped for lighting that candle, which he said could have burned down not only the house, but the whole city. The incident changed my life. Engelhart realized that I would never make a decent lackey, and so he sent me for art lessons. When I was 18, the Baron moved his household to St. Petersburg, where I was apprenticed to the painter Shidaya for 4 years. It was a lucrative arrangement for my master, who made a profit from my work decorating the ceiling of the Imperial Bolshoi Theater. At night, I go to the summer gardens, and there, under the bright northern skies, I sketch the statues in the park's alleys. One night, a young man asked to see what I was drawing. He introduced himself as Ivan Soshenko, a Ukrainian student at the Academy of Art. My sketches impressed him, and he began giving me lessons in color portraiture. This accidental meeting marked a turning point. Through Soshenko, I met the Ukrainian writer Yevhen Nedinka and became acquainted with a wide artistic circle. It included the Russian poet and tutor of Tsarevich Alexander, Zhukovsky, and the noted painter, Bryulov. Without my knowledge, a coterie of academics and artists approached Engelhart to ask him for my freedom. They were not prepared for the outrageous figure of 2,500 rubles that he demanded. But they drafted a plan to raise the money. Bryulov was to paint a portrait of Zhukovsky, which was to be auctioned off at the imperial court. The portrait was bought by the Empress Alexandra Fedorovna. On April 22nd, 1838, Bryulov handed me a document.
Dobrý den, Павло Павлович.
Раді тебе бачити.
документом і тим самим засвідчую, що я назавжди відпускаю на волю свого кріпака Тараса Григоровича Шевченка, який є записаний за мною у документах ревізії в селі Кирилівці з Вигинацького повіту Київської губернії, який дістався мені у спадок від мого батька, дійсного таємного радника Василя Васильовича Енгельгарда. Цим документом я засвідчую, що надалі ні я, Енгельгард, але мої нащадки не мають до цієї людини ніякого відношення. І він, Шевченко, може вибрати такий спосіб життя, який буде його воля. 24 роки я був рабом, а тепер я вільна людина!
I began receiving to the homes of academicians, artists, and writers. I became a student of Bulow's and began classes at the Academy of Art. And how I read to make up for years of ignorance. I devoured Dante, Goethe, Byron, Shakespeare, Schiller, Mickiewicz, Rousseau, Defoe, Dickens. As for my painting, my work earned me 2 medals from the Academy. Later, I became friends with the American-born black Shakespearean actor Ira Aldrich. He was all the rage in London and had come to St. Petersburg at the invitation of the Imperial Theatre. I went to all of his 33 performances in the roles of Othello and Lear. Later, we'd meet at the home of Fedyev Tolstoy, the vice president of the Academy of Arts. Tolstoy's daughter had an excellent command of English and would interpret for us. We became great friends, united by our mutual experience of slavery. The highlight of our friendship was my painting Iris' portrait as a token of my appreciation.
Перестану малювати от і все. Я так не можу.
I don't like that. Well, what if I would sing as you would paint? Then I'd be occupied and I wouldn't be such a nuisance.
То буде набагато краща ідея, ніж ця постійна метушня. Співай, що тобі заманеться.
Thank you. Material and inspiration were the songs of the Kobzari, Ukraine's blind singers. In this set, I'll perform music of the Kobzari on exactly the type of instrument that they would have played. A historical song, a humorous dancing song, and one of their great moralistic songs. Thank you.
біди, а сім літ, славна біда на весь світ. От Києва до Кракова всюди біда єднакова. От Києва до Кракова всюди біда єднакова. На зеленій гірці пасла від 10 літ віці, прийшла від на подзаплату, та все мою крайню хату. Бо я біди ночував, то я біду розпізнав, бо я біди обвідав, то я біду розвидав.
Started calling itself truth. And for the rest of the translation of the text, just look in any newspapers, anywhere in the world, on any given day, for truth is left standing at the door and falsehood sits at the table with the high and mighty, and truth is trampled underfoot. And falsehood whined and dined, and truth thrown into the dungeons, and falsehood invited into the halls of power. Що вже тепер правду ногами топтаю, а вражу неправду над вином напуваю. А вже тепер правда, правда у темниці, а вража.
In his words, it's very difficult to know oneself, but even more difficult to paint yourself. Shevchenko painted nearly 30 self-portraits, examining himself in many mirrors, from a dynamic young man filled with creative energy to a man worn down by 10 years of exile. They constitute his autobiography in paint. Throughout his life, the painter made use of the self-portrait as a means of self-scrutiny, reflecting changes in his state of mind. Uninhibited about producing his own likeness, he continually explored his inner life. He examined his character with brush strokes, contrasting light and dark. He searched for himself from different perspectives, with colors and lines. Shevchenko's visual studies gave him the opportunity to delve into his complex persona and see feature by feature what he was made of. Each self-study is a portrait chronicling Shevchenko's changing circumstances as he watched himself passing through time, growing older, and finally approaching death. In three paintings, Shevchenko cast himself in the background of each scene. He posed and reflected as the creator inside his work. He is both his own subject and observer. Looking back on 10 years of imprisonment, during which time he was prohibited from painting and writing, Shevchenko wrote in his diary, "Not one feature of my inner portrait has changed. Not one bitter experience, not one humiliation with his iron claws has touched my convictions, my childlike beliefs. During my exile, when I had to hide my human dignity, when I had to stand like a soulless automaton and listen to the banal teaching of what constitutes a brave soldier loyal to the Tsar, delivered by a blood-sucking feeding commander, I never gave in." The self-portraits you're about to see compel attention. Shevchenko challenges himself to explore his own psyche. He challenges us with shades of meaning, which the viewer then deciphers for himself. His inner strength and wisdom are there for us to savor. His fragility, his palpable melancholy, particularly in his last works, are there for us to witness. The last self-portraits of a dark, knotted figure tottering on the brink of life and death grip the viewer with a weary but relentless piercing stare. But no matter what anguish, grievance, isolation Shevchenko endured, each self-portrait is free of self-pity. Each is a masterful reflection of a self-made man who steered into the abyss of poverty, injustice, and humiliation, and saw hope.
Thank you.
It seems to speak to Russian and Ukrainian readers alike. My poetry touches all my countrymen, rich and poor, educated and illiterate. But academic critics reacted differently. The Russian critic Bilinski mocked me for wasting my talent scribbling in Little Russian. I rebelled against such hollow criticism. I inherited a Ukrainian language that expresses my spirit in all its cadences. Phrases flow through my veins. Words rise from down deep. They take on their own musical life. My poems come from folk songs, old Slavonic church chants, and minstrel movement, the ballads I heard as a child. They color my stories of Zaporozhye and the Black Sea on their way to the Battle of Tabor. Out of folklore come my images of village life. And the figure of Oksana, a girl born of my dreams, has haunted me since I was 13. She is transformed into Mariana, and the muse who gives me no rest.
Всі відпочивали бабусі літом в селі. Дем'яна, розкажи, а як воно відпочивало? А що тобі запам'яталося?
Дивлюся, аж світає, край небо палає, соловейку в темні має, сонце зустрічає, десенько вітер віє, степи, лани мріють, між ярами над ставами верби зеленіють, сади лісні погилились, то полі поволі, стоять собі, мов сторожа, розмовляють.
Юліан, а що тобі згадується?
І досі сниться під горою, між вербами та над водою, біленька хаточка, сидить наче досі серед днів, колохатиночки й бабить, хорошія, та кучерявлє, свої маленькі вуча, і досі сниться, вийшла з хати, веселою, сміючись мати. Цілує діти і дитя, аж кличі весело цілує, приймає на руки і готує, а дід сидить і усміхається.
Я вам розкажу. Було колись в Україні, ревіли гармати, були колись запорожці, вміли панувати, панували, здобували і славу, і волю. Минулося, зосталися могили на полі, високі ті могили, де лягла спочити сотня небесна, в Китай куповита. Високі ті могили чорніють, мов гори, і про волю нишком полі з вітрами говорять. Свідок слави дідівщини з вітром розмовляє, а внук косу несе в росу, за ними співає. Було колись в Україні, лихо танцювало, журба в шинку, мед, горілку поставцем кружала. Україні. А згадаймо, може серце хоч трохи спочине. Чорна хмара за лиману, небо сонце криє. Чорне море звірюкою, то стогне, то виє. Дніпро гирло затопило, а нумо хлоп'ята, на байдаки море грає, ходім погуляти. Висипали запорожці, лиман човни вкрили, грай же море заспівали, запінились хвилі. Кругом хвилі, мов ті гори, не землі, ні неба, серце мліє, а козакам тільки того треба. Пливуть собі та співають. Рибалка літає, а попереду отаман веде, куди знає. Походжає вздовж байдака, гасне люлька в роті, поглядає туди-сюди, де то будь роботі. Закрутивши чорні вуса, за вухо чоприну, підняв шапку, човни стали. Нехай ворогине! Не в Синопу, отамани, панове молодці, а в Москву до царевича поїдемо в гості. Добре, батько, отамани, кругом заревіло. Спасибі вам. Одів шапку, знову закипіло. Чорне море вздовж байдака собі походжає, пан отаман, і на хвилю мовчки поглядає.
Чи правда, Оксано, чужа чорнобрива, і ти не згадаєш того сироту, що в сірій святині бувало щасливий, як диво, побачить твою красоту, кого ти без мови, без слова навчила очима, душею, серцем любить? Кому ти любила Петруся співати? Згадай же, Оксано, чужа чорнобрива, і сестру Мар'яну рястому квітчай, і на Петруся подивись щаслива, і хоч так як жарти, колишнє згадай.
На вихідні
Вона гляне, усміхнеться і сама не знає. Може, думаєш, покину? Ні, моя репчино, буду ходити, буду любити, поки не загину. Моя Мар'яно, отдам тебе за пана, за старшого. тяжко заридали. Аж до вечора Мар'яна у темному гаю проплакала. Прийшов Петрусь. Вона розказала все, що чула від матері і що сама знала. І не втерпіла. Сказала, як п'яні придани йшли по вулиці, співали. Мар'яно! Мар'яно! Чом ти не вбога? Чом я не багатий? Чом у мене коней горлих нема? Не питала б мати, де ходиш гуляти, з ким колись стояла. Питала б сама, сама свого серця. Дала б йому волю любить, кого знає. Я б тебе сховав. Далеко, далеко. Щоб ніхто не знав, щоб ніхто не бачив, де витає доля. Моя доля, моє щастя, ти, моя Мар'яна. Чом не ти в сірій святині? Чом я не в жупані?
Thank you.
occasion. It's not he who's revealed by the painter, it's rather the painter who on the canvas reveals himself. These words aptly apply to Shevchenko, who transformed his uncommon sensitivity, impressionable nature, and curiosity into the nearly 100 portraits he painted. The portraits not only reveal the artist's masterful techniques, but his sheer pleasure in drawing the human form rather than in satisfying a commissioning client. Shevchenko's studies of the human figure demonstrate a wealth of expressive features. The half-length portraits of Olga Marlenko, Yelisaveta Kekuatova, and Majewska are enigmatic portrayals of the female sensibility to which Shevchenko was drawn. Exquisite details of headdress, rich textures of dresses and collars, contrasts in skin tones, heighten our awareness of their beauty and invite us into the world of Shevchenko's originality. In the portrait of Ihor Aldrich, Shevchenko's rapport with the black actor is worked into a painterly dialogue between the painter and his subject. His harmonizing of colors and lines, as well as natural empathy, evoke Aldrich's character. From his first attempts at portraiture with the study of his master Engelhardt, Shevchenko was continually expanding his field of vision in his depictions of Prince Repnin's strength of character, Fedor Tolstoy's good nature, Kulish's melancholy visage. Shevchenko's range of painterly skills and versatile use of watercolors, oils, charcoal, and etching bring his paintings vividly to life. In the field of etching, he was recognized as a leading innovator of his time. His paintings of the gypsy fortune teller, a Ukrainian village family, a village tribunal, a fire in the steppe, show wealth of artistic subjects. To go beyond these fleeting glimpses of Shevchenko's art, to find these artworks on our own in their historical context, to slow down and look at their intricate details and let them come in inside of us at our leisure, for our pleasure, that is the challenge Shevchenko provides.
Thank you.
been obsessively watching the internet news from Ukraine the last while. And ever since November when this whole thing started. And one thing which just keeps coming back again and again is this feeling that that the leadership just isn't on the level of the people. They're still trying to catch up. That the people are way ahead of it. Here's an 18th century song about that.
Thank you.
була гайдамацька пісня «Гей, скинемось по таляру», яку вивчив від свого батька Петра Кетаста. Друга композиція його родича, брата мого діда Григорія Кетаста, «Гомін степі». Ну, а на закінчення вертаємося все-таки до Шевченка. I'll finish with a poem by Shevchenko. And Shevchenko is, as you know by now probably, notoriously difficult to translate, very difficult to translate well. And also very difficult, by the way, to set the music well. And I think one of the big reasons for that is that Shevchenko himself was such, as a poet, was such a musician of the word. His intonations, sounds, rhythms are so good that any music just spoils it. And I'll do a poem of his. It's from a longer poem. It's a section which is a prayer. And don't worry about the translation if you're not a Ukrainian speaker. Just make it up. Listen, it's enough to know that it's a prayer, and listen to Shevchenko's sound. Ти матір Бога на землі, ти сльози матері до краю, до каплі вилила, ридаю, молю ридаючи, пошли, подай душі убогій силу, щоб огнено заговорила, щоб слово пламенем взялось, щоб людям серце розтопило, і на Україні понеслось, і на Україні святилось те слово, Божеє кадило, кадило істини.
Thank you.
Shevchenko's fury falls not only on the intellectual and merchant classes of his day. In his poem, Poslania, he mocks the apathy and weakness of the Ukrainian elite. Wrathful and ironic, he exposes the abuses of the privileged classes. His words speak to today's oligarchs, corrupted by money and power. He appeals to them to act responsibly. He calls for a renewal of communal spirit and mutual respect. He also recognizes the importance of self-assertion and self-determination. He implores every Ukrainian to study his and her history, learn from the past mistakes, think for himself, wake up to her own strengths and weaknesses. On his 200th birthday, Shevchenko takes his place alongside the greatest poets of the world. His verse, a project of soul-making, stands alongside the works of Goethe, Byron, Whitman, and Pushkin. In his day, he stood for liberty. Today, he speaks to us as a pioneer in the struggle for democratic freedom and justice.
І мертвим, і живим,
і ненародженим,
землякам моїм в Україні і не в Україні моє дружнє послання.
І смеркає, і світає, день Божий минає, і знову люд потомлений, і все спочиває. Тільки я, мов окаянний, і день, і ніч плачу на розпутях велелюдних, і ніхто не бачить, і не бачить, і не знає. Оглухли, не чують, кайданами міняються, правдою торгують, і Господа зневажають, людей запрягають в тяжкі ярма, орють лихо, лихом засівають. А що вродить? Побачите, які будуть жнива.
Схаменіться, недолюди, діти юродиві. Подивіться на рай тихий, на свою країну. Полюбіть щирим серцем велику руїну. Розкуйтеся, братайтеся.
У чужому краю не шукайте, не питайте того, що немає і на небі, а не тільки на чужому полі. В своїй хаті своя правда, і сила, і воля.
Нема на світі України, немає другого Дніпра, а ви претесь на чужину, шукати доброго добра, добра святого, волі, волі. Братерства братнього знайшли, несли з чужого поля і в Україну принесли великих слов, велику силу та й більш нічого. Кричите, що Бог создав вас не на те, щоб ви не правді поклонились, і хилитесь, як і хилились, і знову шкуру дерете з братів незрящих гречкосіїв. І сонця правди дозрівать в німецькі землі, не чужії.
придеться знову. Якби взяти всю мізерію з собою, дідами крадене добро, тоді остався без сиротою, святими горами Дніпро.
Ох, якби те сталось, щоб ви не вертались,
щоб там і здихали,
де ви поросли. Не плакали б діти, мати б не ридала, не чули б у Бога вашої хули, і сонце не гріло б смердячого гною на чистій, широкій, на вольній землі. І люди б не знали, що ви за орли, і не покивали б на вас головою.
Схаменіться, будьте люди, бо лихо вам буде, розкуються незабаром заковані люди. Настане суд, заговорять і Дніпро, і гори, і потече сторіками кров у синє море дітей ваших. І не буде кому помагати, отсурається брат брата, і дитини мати, і тим хмарою заступить сонце перед вами, і навіки проклинетесь своїми синами.
Помийтеся, образ Божий поганом не скверніте, не дуріте дітей ваших, що вони на світі на те тільки, щоб панувати, бо невчене око загляне їм саму душу, глибоко, глибоко.
Якби ви вчились так, як треба, то й мудрість би була своя, а то залізете на небо. І ми не ми, і я не я, і все те бачив, і все знаю. Нема ні пекла, ані раю, немає й Бога, тільки я. Таку зінімецу зловатий, а більш нікого.
Добре, брате, що ж ти таке? Нехай скаже німець, ми не знаємо. Отак-то ви навчаєтесь у чужому краю. Німець каже, ви моголи.
Моголи, моголи.
Золотого Тамерлана онучата гонь. Німець каже, ви слав'яне.
Слав'яне, слав'яне.
Славних прадідів великих, правнуки погані.
І в слав'янофіли, так і братець, і всі мови слав'янського люди, всі знаєте, а своєї дасть бі. Колись будемо і по-своєму глаголи, як німець покаже, та до того історію нашу нам розкаже. Ото й ті ми заходились, добре заходились по німецькому показу і заговорили так, що й німець не второпа, учитель великий, а не те, що прості люди.
А гвалту, а крику, і гармонія, і сила, музика, та й годі, а історія, поема вольного народу. У нас воля виростала, Дніпро умивалась, у голови гори слала, степом укривалась, кров'ю вона умивалась, а спала на купах, на козацьких вольних трупах, окрадених трупах.
Подивіться лишень добре, прочитайте знову тую славу та читайте от слова до слова. Не минайте ані титли, ні житії кови. Все розберіть та й спитайте, що ми, чиї сини, яких батьків, ким, за що закуті, то й побачите, що ось що ваші славні брути, раби, подножки, грязь Москви, варшавські сміття, ваші пани, ясновельможні гетьмани. Чого ж ви чванитеся, ви, що добре ходили в дірмі, що лучше, як батьки ходили?
І на Січі мудрий німець картопельку садить, а ви її купуєте, їсте на здоров'я та славити Запорожжя. А чиєю кров'ю ота земля напоєна? вам байдуже, аби добра була для городу, а чванитесь, що ми Польщу колись завалили. Правда ваша, Польща впала, та й вас придавила. Так от я кров свою лили, батьки за Москву, за Варшаву, і вам, синам, передали свої кайдани, свою славу.
Доборолась Україна до самого краю. Гірше ляха свої діти її розпинають. Замість пива праведною кров із ребер точать. Просвітити, кажуть, хочуть материні очі современними огнями. Повести за віком, за німцями недоріку, сліпую каліку.
Добре, ведіть, показуйте. Нехай стара мати навчається, як дітей тих нових доглядати. Показуйте, за науку не турбуйтесь. Буде, материна, добра плата. Розпадеться луда на очах ваших неситих і побачите славу. Живуть славу дідів своїх і батьків лукавих.
Не дуріть самі себе, учитесь, читайте. І чужому навчайтесь, і свого не цурайтесь. Бо хто матір забуває, того Бог карає. Того діти цураються, в хату не пускають. Чужі люди проганяють, і немає злому на всій землі безкінечній веселого дому.
Я ридаю, як згадаю, діла незабуті дідів наших. Тяжкі діла! Як би їх забути, я віддав би веселого віку половину. Отака-то наша слава, слава України. Отак і ви прочитайте, щоб не сонним снились всі неправди, щоб розкрились високі могили перед вашими очима, щоб ви розпитали мучеників, кого, коли, за що розпитали.
Обійміте ж, брати мої, найменшого брата, нехай мати усміхнеться, заплакана мати, благословить дітей своїх твердими руками, і діточок поцілує вольними устами, і забудеться срамотня давня година, і оживе добра слава, слава України. І світ ясний, невечірній, тихо засіяє. Обніміться ж, брати мої, молю вас, благаю.
Zapovit, the testament of Shevchenko, I would like to extend my sincere thanks to all of you for coming out for this concert tonight, and also to the many people who have worked diligently behind the scenes, before and during this concert. And I would also like to thank all the performers that did, I think, a super job today. In particular, two people deserve a special mention for making this event a reality, and that is Oksana Ivashchenko, who's responsible for all the logistics, including putting together the program booklet, the costumes, the lights, the hall rentals, the posters, and has been in the booth up there during today's performance. She has worked nonstop for the last 3 months. The second person is Irina Kowal, who conceived, wrote, and directed the three tableaus and narrated and performed today. On behalf of the Shevchenko 2200 Committee, I thank on April 6th, which is a Sunday, at the St. Andrew's Ukrainian Orthodox Church Hall in Forest Hills, there will be an art and recitation competition for children. And this will start at 12:30. Let me just say a few words in Ukrainian. Ваша екселенція, сечесніші отці, пані і панове, ми ще добігаємо до кінця нашого концерту. І перед тим, коли ми всі станемо і заспіваємо Заповіт, я б хотів подякувати всім виконавцям сьогоднішнього свята і також всім людям, які так пильно працювали до і під час концерту. Є дві особи, без яких наш концерт не міг би відбутися, а саме Оксана Івашенко, яка провадила всю логістику, включаючи складення програмної книжечки, замовлення залі, костюмів, світла, афіші і так далі. Також треба згадати Ірину Коваль, яка написала і режисувала треті сценки, як і також виконувала певні читання сьогодні. Шевченка в Бостоні. Це є дитячий конкурс декламації і малювання. І цей конкурс відбудеться в залі Православної церкви Святого Андрія Forest Hills. Це буде в неділю 6 квітня 12:30 годин. Дякую.
Oh,
одного чоловіка, які нас всіх настільки заставляли працювати і віддали, то не є кусочок душі. Вони кусочок себе залишили в кожному.